We can define several major events in cirrhosis pathogenesis. First of all, is liver injury that leads to alterations in liver sinusoid functional unit and hepatic stellate cells activation. These two events basically occur simultaneously, but for the sake of simplicity, we can divide on processes that occur with hepatic stellate cells, because it's the key cells in fibrogenesis, and processes that occur with other cells of liver sinusoid functional unit. Activated hepatic stellate cells start to excessively secrete scar tissue to save hepatocytes from inflammation. This scar tissue forms fibrous bands that encircle hepatocytes with formation of regenerative nodule. Now about each step in details. Regardless of course, it can be ischemic injury, drug-induced liver injury, or viral hepatitis, direct damage to hepatocytes leads to their death. And there are three types of hepatocyte death. It's necrosis, apoptosis, and necroptosis. Each of them, to some extent, is present in every pathological condition, but for example, in ischemic injury or drug-induced liver injury, necrosis is predominant, but in chronic hepatitis C infection, the dominant form of cell death is apoptosis. Necrosis is uncontrolled death of a large group of cells, followed by acute inflammation. As an example, in toxic injury, cell reaches a critical point of cell loss stress and energy depletion, and at this condition, cells lose their ability to maintain basic homeostasis. This results in defects in osmosis regulation that leads to cellular swelling and eventually cellular rupture with subsequent acute inflammation. Apoptosis is a programmed, non-inflammatory cell death that involves a single or a small group of cells. Apoptosis occurs by shrinkage of the cell, followed by cellular fragmentation into apoptotic bodies, and these apoptotic bodies are removed by macrophages, so apoptosis is a clean cellular death without inflammation. As an example of apoptosis, when hepatitis C virus infects hepatocytes, the cell begins to produce endogenous proteins of this virus that are presented on hepatocyte surface by MHC1 molecule, and when CD8 positive T cells screen MHC1 molecule on their surface, they recognize viral proteins and kill virally infected cells by apoptosis. Necroptosis is a relatively new term. Basically, it's a combination of necrosis and apoptosis. The similar feature with apoptosis is that it's a programmed process of cellular death. But unlike apoptosis, this process results in rupture of plasma membrane with subsequent release of cellular content. So like necrosis, this process results in substantial inflammation. The principle is that direct damage to liver cells leads to release of reactive oxygen species and other pro-inflammatory mediators that cause activation of immune cells and thereby promote inflammation, and inflammation triggers changes in endothelial cells and hepatocytes and also triggers hepatic cell activation. As we said, these processes occur simultaneously, but to simplify, we can divide on processes that occur with hepatic stellate cells to emphasize their importance, and processes that occur with other cells of liver sinusoid functional unit. First of all, there is substantial changes in endothelial cells. Endothelial cells undergo capillarization. The principle is that endothelial cells lose their fenestration, and if they lose their fenestration, they start to look like a regular capillary vessel. That's why this process is named capillarization. The problem is that in normal condition, fenestration facilitates nutrients delivery from blood to hepatocytes. And if endothelial cells lose their fenestration, nutrients delivery to hepatocytes decrease, and this leads to hepatocyte energy depletion state with progressive decrease in their function. Also, when endothelial cells receive pro-inflammatory signals, they start to produce transforming growth factor beta-1, which is the major fibrogenic factor that stimulates activation of hepatic stellate cells. In addition to endothelial cells, hepatocytes also undergo structural changes. They lose their microvilli. In normal condition, microvilli increase the hepatocyte surface area, and the greater is the surface area, the greater is the absorption capacity. But because of capillarization and also because of changes in extracellometric structure that we will discuss further, nutrients delivery is decreased. So if there are not so much nutrients to absorb, that's why there is no need in so large surface area, that's why hepatocytes lose their microvilli. Also, Kupffer cells became activated and start to excessively secrete pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines. Hepatic stellate cells activation is a key step in fibrogenesis. The major stimuli for their activation are first of all inflammation that causes permanent oxidant stress, and hepatic stellate cells became activated in order to limit the inflamed area by scar tissue production. Also, disruption of extracellometric space can stimulate hepatic stellate cells activation because if extracellometric space is damaged, hepatic solar cells became activated to secrete additional extracellular matrix to repair the damaged area. Because cut tissue is working like biological glue to keep tissue unity, hepatic solar cells can be activated by paracrine stimulation. For example, Kupffer cells after antigen stimulation can activate hepatic solar cells by paracrine stimuli. And direct toxin stimulation can activate hepatic solar cells, for example, acetaminophen intoxication. And with activation, there are substantial changes in hepatic solar cell structure. Remember that hepatic solar cells in normal condition are the major storage site of vitamin A in the body, but inflammation causes energy depletion state, and to maintain energy homeostasis, hepatic solar cells hydrolyze retinoid droplets for free fatty acids that are used as energy source. The second feature is that with activation there is increase in hepatic solar cells contractility. The increase in contractility is caused by increase in expression of smooth muscle specific proteins, alpha-actin and myosin. The contractility of hepatic solar cells is regulated primarily by two mediators, endothelin-1 that stimulate contractility and nitric oxide that decrease contractility. The logic of this process is that when hepatocytes die, the tissue defect is created, and the defect must be repaired by hepatic solar cells' connective tissue secretion. And the principle is that the smaller is the defect, the less extracellular matrix and time is needed to repair the defect. So by contraction, hepatic solar cells decrease the size of the defect, thereby decreasing healing time and also decreasing of oversynthesis of extracellular matrix. But the problem is that contraction can affect blood vessels. For example, in normal condition, in intrahepatic circulation, blood from portal vein is going to sinusoids and then to hepatic vein. But tissue contraction can affect sinusoids, and contraction leads to decrease in sinusoid radius, and decrease in sinusoid radius causes increase in sinusoid resistance, because resistance is inversely proportional to the fourth power of radius. And increased resistance causes rise in intrasinusoid pressure, because from Ohm law we know that pressure difference between pressure 1, which is the pressure where sinusoid vessel begin, minus pressure 2, which is the pressure in the end of sinusoid vessel, is equal to flow on resistance. So with increase in intrasinusoid resistance, the pressure difference is increased, primarily by increase in pressure in the afferent vent of the vessel, and this increased pressure is transmitted to the upstream vessel, which is portal vein, and cause increase in portal pressure, and increase in portal pressure called portal hypertension. So that's how increase in hepatic solar cells contractility can contribute to portal hypertension development in cirrhosis. Also, with activation, hepatic solar cells begin to produce cytokines and chemokines to regulate inflammatory processes. The most important feature is that hepatic solar cells begin to excessively secrete altered extracellular matrix, that we will discuss further, and through activation, hepatic solar cells became myofibroblasts. So, as we said, there are alterations in extracellular matrix secretion, which is the most characteristic feature of cirrhosis. First of all, there is alterations in extracellular matrix composition, because if glycoproteins and proteoglycans remain relatively constant, the collagen is totally different. Recall that the normal connective tissue matrix is composed of collagen type 4, which is non-fibroforming type of collagen, and the collagen type 4 molecules are linked with each other by head-to-head connection. This results in very thin and soft structure. In contrast to this, during inflammation, instead of collagen type 4, hepatic solar cells secrete collagen type 1 and 3, that are fibril-forming type of collagens. This means that these collagen molecules are connected with each other by parallel fashion, thereby forming assembly of collagen molecules, that's called fibrils. And this results in very dense, thick extracellular matrix structure. Basically, it's a scar tissue. And because the structure of extracellular matrix became very dense and thick, this leads to tissue stiffening and loss of organ function. Because in normal condition, extracellular matrix is very thin, and it's easy for nutrients from sinusoid vessel to diffuse through such extracellular matrix to hepatocytes. So the nutrients diffusion rate is very fast. In cirrhosis, extracellular matrix is very thick, and it's very difficult for nutrients to diffuse through such extracellular matrix. So there is decrease in nutrients diffusion rate, and this leads to hepatocyte's energy depletion state. So basically, instead of fragile extracellular matrix that in normal conditions serves for metabolic purposes, to maintain metabolic exchange between blood and hepatocytes, during inflammation, hepatic solar cells secrete very thick and dense extracellular matrix that serves for protective purposes, primarily as a barrier to save hepatocytes from inflammation by formation of regenerative nodules. So, as we already mentioned, the most specific feature in cirrhosis is the production of fibril-forming collagen type 1 and 3 instead of collagen type 4. And this altered extracellular matrix produced excessively by hepatic stellate cells. This excessive production is caused by two factors, primarily by secretion of transformin growth factor beta 1 that is secreted primarily by endothelial cells. And this molecule causes 3 to 8 fold increase in extracellular matrix synthesis. And the second factor is decrease in extracellular matrix degradation. This decrease in fibrinolysis is caused first of all by decrease in matrix metalloproteinases level and also by increase in the level of tissue inhibitors of matrix metalloproteinases. The mechanism is that macrophages secrete matrix metalloproteinases that degrade extracellular matrix. Obviously, if the level of their secretion by macrophages decrease, fibrinolysis will decrease. Also, the activity of matrix metalloproteinases is regulated by tissue inhibitors of matrix metalloproteinases. Recall that matrix metalloproteinases are calcium-dependent, zinc-containing endopeptidases, and these inhibitors bind to catalytic zinc of matrix metalloproteinases active site, and by this binding, they markedly decrease matrix metalloproteinases activity. So, if injury persists, myofibroblasts continue to excessively secrete in space of diseases altered extracellular matrix, that is actually scar tissue. And with this secretion, hepatic stellate cells fill in zones of parenchyma loss with connective tissue, with formation of dense fibroceptors. So, basically, zones with dead hepatocytes are transformed into dense fibroceptors. And these dense fibroceptors keep tissue unity and also encircle alive hepatocytes to protect them from inflammation with formation of regenerative nodules. And the longer injury persists, the more diffuse is liver fibrosis, so the more severe will be cirrhosis. So it's a pathogenesis of formation of classical cirrhosis picture.